Welcome to the State of the University Address, sponsored by the Academic Senate. I'd like to thank you all for being here, and I would especially like to thank our sign language interpreter, Ms. Janelle Wiegand. My name's Dan Holland. I'm from the Physics Department, and I'm currently the chair of the Academic Senate. And for those of you who have not actively been involved in the Senate, it is the primary governing body of Illinois State University, and it allows for participation in our shared governance by all stakeholders, students, civil service, AP, faculty associates, and occasionally even faculty and administrators. Any member of the academic community may bring issues of concern to the Senate by contacting the Senate office through an appropriate Senate committee or an individual senator. And I've always got to give my advertisement here. There are many opportunities available to serve either on the Senate or one of its many external committees. This year, however, I am happy to say that we have filled all of our internal and external committees. But in the spring, you will be receiving solicitation for volunteers for next year. I encourage you to participate in whatever way you can, and I think you will find it both an enlightening and enjoyable experience. You'll certainly get to meet people from across campus that you would never have met before. This is a great time to be a Redbird. Even though we are still in uncertain economic times and the nation seems to be more divided than at any time in my lifetime, which is somewhat long at this point, there are amazing things happening at ISU. I'll leave the details for President Bowman, but even a cursory glance of the university report over the past year is a testament to the creativity, hard work, and entrepreneurship of the campus community. While many schools are having trouble just making enrollments, ours is the highest it's been since 1992. To go along with this, our tenure and tenure-track faculty numbers are at an all-time high. The numbers and quality of the cultural offerings throughout the university is downright inspiring, be it fine arts, music, theater, dance, sports, or lectures on any number of topics. ISU is a significant contributor to the overall quality of life in Central Illinois. You may recall that a few years ago at this time, I introduced a measure of success for the university of my own. It's just reading t-shirts as you walk across campus. What you will find is that there are a large number of ISU shirts as compared to any other university. This wasn't always the case, but our friend and colleague Chuck McGuire suggested we can do even better. When you see someone from a shirt from a different school, might be bright orange, for instance, show your pride in ISU. Welcome them to our campus. Offer to show them around. You are, after all, in a wonderful place. As is the custom, President Bowman will speak for approximately 30 minutes, and then the floor will be open for questions. I find this to be incredibly brave. Following the address, please join us for a reception in the lobby. And it's now my pleasure to introduce the 17th president of Illinois State University, Dr. Al Bowman.
Thank you, Dan. I appreciate that wonderful, warm introduction. And you are exactly right. It is a great time to be a Redbird. I would like to take just a couple of moments to introduce a couple of people, beginning first with our trustees, Joanne Maitland, Betty Kinzer, Bob Dobsky, and our student trustee, Sean Palmer. We also have trustee emeritus Bill Salasky here today. And from the General Assembly, our good friends, Senator John Maitland, Representative Keith Summer, Representative Dan Brady, and our own alum, Representative Jason Berrickman, and Senator Bill Brady. We also have our fearless mayor, Chris Coos. Thank you all for being here today. Also like to thank my wife for being here and for being a partner in this wonderful excursion that she and I have enjoyed the last 8 years. Any major speech like this is a collaborative effort. And I would, first of all, like to thank our four vice presidents, as well as deans, department chairs, and school directors for all the input that went in to today's address. Since my last State of the University address a year ago, I have read literally dozens of book chapters, magazine articles, journal submissions, and news accounts relating to higher education. After digesting all of this information, here is my general assessment. Don't run for the doors. The target on the back of higher education is getting bigger, and the enterprise is drawing more fire. For faculty and staff members, the targets are salaries, governance, accreditation standards, freedoms, retirement options, and yes, let's not forget the state's clumsy management of benefit choices for its employees. For students and families, the lack of state and federal support has pushed the investment in a college education higher, while the number and value of loans and grants available to help fund that investment continue to shrink. Even the value of pursuing a university degree has too become the target of a very political and target of the very political and corporate institutions that used to point to higher education as the way out, the ultimate path to success. Higher learning has become devalued and deprioritized, the victim of an economy trying to edge away from financial calamity and a scapegoat of the paranoid. At least 35 states expect budget shortfalls, many of which surpass their higher education allowances in 2012, and colleges in some states are bearing the brunt of those cuts. 13 states have chopped their higher education budgets by more than 10% over the last 2 years. In North Carolina, which has traditionally had strong state support for education, double-digit cuts have prompted departmental consolidations and are threatening many academic employees. In California, San Francisco State has eliminated 300 courses, 61 tenure-track faculty, and 216 lecturers. They have the same number of students as they had 5 years ago, but 16% fewer instructors. For some courses, students enter a lottery for needed classes. Closer to home, news accounts regarding most Illinois public universities share a common theme. Layoffs, furlough days, salary freezes, declining enrollment, partial dormitory closures, dissension between universities and their governing boards, conflict between university administration and its faculty and staff, and unfortunately, widespread misuse of scarce state resources. I'm not going to name names other than to name the university that has not been the subject of any of these troubling accounts. That, of course, is Illinois State University. It's under these circumstances that I want to thank and congratulate this campus community for not only working hard, but for helping Illinois State progress in an extremely challenging and competitive environment. Over the past decade, Illinois State has rightfully patted itself on the back for charting its own course, working as one community to create and follow its own priorities, and setting itself apart from other Illinois public universities. Setting ourselves apart. 10 years ago, we used that phrase as a marketing mantra. Today, it's an accurate description of this campus, and it's part of the reason we're able to thrive while others struggle to survive. During last year's State of the University message, we talked about the Chronicle of Higher Education's estimate that over the next 10 years, 6,000 fewer students will graduate from Illinois high schools. I cautioned that the decrease would mean greater competition from both public and private universities as institutions compete for market position by shaping their enrollment profiles. I challenged Illinois State to maintain and even strengthen its position in student recruitment, to prioritize scarce resources, and create more financial incentives for students to attend, and to remain committed to the best in teaching, research, and service. On almost every measure, this campus has answered that challenge. While our freshman applicant pool was slightly smaller than last year's, we still received 4,000 more applications this year than we did in the year 2000. By building on our core strengths with thorough and effective strategic planning, along with enhanced marketing and communications, this 2011-2012 academic year has brought us a talented class of students, and as Dan mentioned, the largest student population since 1992. Our new freshman enrollment stands at 3,321. Transfer enrollment tops 1,826. Our total student population is 21,080, just barely over our 20 to 21,000 target. But in this environment of economic malaise and heightened competition, I think you'll agree that it's a circumstance we can not only live with, but should applaud. Finding university housing, on the other hand, was no easy task this year. And I'd like to thank our new Vice President for Student Affairs, Dr. Larry Dietz, along with University Housing Director Maureen Blair and the entire housing staff for their quick and efficient work. Class diversity is also higher than last year, with non-white students comprising about 18% of the incoming freshman class. The biggest jump was in African-American enrollment, with an increase of 26% over last year. Academic quality of our students remains strong, with an incoming ACT average near 24 and a grade point average of 3.38. In fact, this year, almost three times as many students with an ACT of 33, we have almost three times as many students this year with an ACT of 33 to 36 as we did last year. Our freshman to sophomore retention rate remains the second highest in the state at 85.1%, and our graduation rate remains at the historic high of 71%. But perhaps the following piece of information says the most about Illinois State's commitment to student quality. According to the Chronicle Almanac, from 2003 until 2008, Illinois State's graduation rate rose a whopping 11%. Among all of the public research universities in these United States, only five bettered that 11% leap, and only one of the five has a higher graduation rate than Illinois State. Ladies and gentlemen, that is simply remarkable. Thank you. Thank you. Not only is it remarkable, it's also ironic, since the headline for the article read, "Graduation rates fall at one-third of four-year colleges." Other Illinois public universities were referenced in the analysis, and again, though I won't name names, to say Illinois State University is bucking the trend would be a huge understatement. Our ability to recruit and retain highly talented students costs money. Much of it in the form of need and merit-based aid to students. This year, Illinois State will spend more than $8 million through university access grants to support more than 2,200 students with the greatest financial need. But that investment does not allow us to ignore financial awards based on achievement. Funds that help Illinois State attract some of the most academically gifted students in the state. Our presidential scholars, students who receive Illinois State's largest merit-based financial incentive, achieved an ACT average of 32.7, more than a point higher than last year's recipients. Their grade point average exceeds 4.0 on a four-point scale. Honors Director Kim Pierre is with us today and has brought three of our new presidential scholars. Kelsey Bunner is a sophomore theater acting major and dance minor. This summer, she was a participant in the US-UK Fulbright Summer Institute at Newcastle University, Newcastle, England. Lori Sopet studied in Spain for a full semester and this past summer in Argentina. She is a senior, a Bone Scholar, and a Spanish major who did volunteer hours at Western Avenue Community Center during the spring semester of her freshman year. Amy Weingant is a senior math major and a Bone Scholar. She received a grant this summer for an experience for undergraduates funded by the National Science Foundation. Would you all please stand and let us recognize you? Thank you. In addition to the more than 50 merit-based scholarships offered to new freshmen through the Presidential and University Scholars programs, more than 600 students are assisted annually through scholarship programs funded by gifts to the Illinois State Foundation. You may also remember during last year's State of the University address, I announced that beginning this fall, we would commit additional funds for merit-based scholarships for academically talented incoming students. Pleased to tell you today that those scholarships will assist more than 475 students, students who achieved an average ACT of 27 and a 3.8 grade point average. These students are attracted to a campus that has talented faculty and staff members and first-rate academic programs. Just 3 weeks ago, we learned that Risk Management Magazine had recognized Illinois State University's Katy School of Insurance and Financial Services as the third-ranked school in the nation for the number of graduates in insurance and risk management programs. The Katy School graduated 142 insurance and risk management students in the 2010-2011 academic year. Risk Management Magazine noted that the other top producers included University of Georgia, Temple University, as well as the University of Wisconsin-Madison and Florida State. Illinois State is ranked fifth in the nation as a Peace Corps Master's International School. The Peace Corps Master's program has been in place since 1997, offers graduate programs in applied economics, political science, and sociology. Several more Illinois State programs also placed in the nation's top 20, including accounting, actuarial sciences, and professional sales. Business Week magazine once again ranked our College of Business as one of the country's best undergraduate business schools. Illinois State is listed among the top 100 schools nationwide and the third highest ranking undergraduate business school in the state of Illinois. And of course, just a few weeks ago, the 2011 U.S. News and World Report rankings placed Illinois State among the top 100 public universities in the country. How about that? Thank you. I'm also excited to announce today that our corporate MBA program will be expanding to Chicago in the fall of 2012. Demand for the MBA degree is strong, and our corporate MBA model serves working professionals in a cohort setting with intense weekend classes. This year, our Department of Agriculture marks 100 years, celebrating major growth in programs from its beginnings with one sole professor in 1911. Today, the department comprises 28 faculty and staff and more than 340 undergraduate and graduate students. In the College of Education, our Special Education Assistive Technology Center celebrates 10 years of operation, preparing future teachers to better educate students with disabilities and making significant contributions to the field of assistive technology. The SEAT Center has supported every student majoring in education at Illinois State over the last 10 years, including over 5,000 students enrolled in the Department of Special Education courses and over 1,200 students in other College of Ed courses. Working across academic disciplines and administrative divisions, Illinois State was the only recipient of the 2011 New York Times Political Engagement Project Program of Excellence Award. The award recognizes the efforts of faculty and staff to provide opportunities for students in the classroom, on campus, and in the community to develop skills related to political processes and leadership. Illinois State is a model for campuses across the country and is seen as an innovator in the field. The program is part of the American Democracy Project. Among our faculty, Dave Lewis from Economics and faculty and staff colleagues from the Center for Renewable Energy have received a great deal of positive attention for studies, data, and expertise on wind energy and other forms of renewable energy. Dr. Loomis has been interviewed by news outlets across the country, and studies by the center have been cited in numerous news articles, blogs, and trade publications. Chad McAvoy, Associate Professor of Sport Management in the School of Kinesiology and Recreation, is recognized nationwide as an authority on the legal aspects of collegiate and professional sports. He has been interviewed by and his studies cited by major newspapers such as USA Today and New York Times. And Shelley Malin is the Advocate Bowman Endowed Professor in the Mennonite College of Nursing. As an endowed professor, she works with faculty and Advocate Bowman nursing leadership and staff to facilitate nursing excellence through research, evidence-based practice, and professional development. These are just a few of the literally hundreds of people and programs that define greatness at Illinois State. As faculty and staff members, your talent and commitment is the foundation of our every success. Although our turbulent economy has forced me to maintain tight restrictions on staff hiring, I'm pleased to note, as Dan mentioned earlier, that we have added 39 new faculty members for this fiscal year. I consider it a foregone conclusion that excellent faculty and staff deserve fair and competitive salary and benefit package, access to current technology, and high-quality facilities. Despite an FY12 state appropriation reduction of about 1.5%, Illinois State was able to offer merit-based salary increases averaging 3%. We accomplished this goal by making it a priority and by adjusting our spending plan to accommodate the additional cost. Through careful planning, we were also able to provide a modest 2% increase for departmental operating budgets, the first in several years. Our success in grant and private fundraising has allowed us to reallocate resources to other campus priorities. The Division of University Advancement reports that fundraising for FY11 totaled more than $13.5 million. That is a $1.2 million increase over FY10 and represents a 10.3% increase in growth in funds raised over the past year. Not only were more dollars raised, but the number of donors also increased. FY11 brought more alumni donors than last year, with a total of 9,183 alumni donors. I'm also grateful that more of you have given back to this institution. Gladly We Give ended last year with a 7% increase in the number of retirees, faculty, and staff members who financially supported the areas of Illinois State that mean the most to them. Last year, for the first time, Gladly We Give raised more than $1 million. I appreciate your gifts, your financial commitment to Illinois State, and your other contributions. Grant activity also reached an all-time high. For 2011, grants for Illinois State totaled $33 million, easily eclipsing our record of $22.3 million set in 2008. During the past decade, Illinois State has received nearly $210 million in grants from federal and state agencies and private organizations, and more than 100 Illinois State faculty members have received grants totaling more than $1 million. As I look at our physical campus environment, it's clear that we've made great strides over the past several years. But it's equally clear that a number of areas still need to be addressed. We've supported our academic facilities, beginning with the complete renovation of Schrader Hall, and by making life safety improvements to Stevenson and Turner Halls. Those improvements seem like old news, but I remind you that those projects represent the last large-scale Illinois capital investment in Illinois State University. Fighting an uphill battle against the economy, the state has tried to be supportive with the help of our local legislators. I want to thank State Representative Dan Brady, Senator Bill Brady, for recently securing $400,000 in capital funds for renovations at University High School. Still, the limited availability of state capital funds has led to a wealth of campus innovation, and we have continued building toward the future. In support of academic facilities, just this fall, we opened a 10,000 square foot expansion of the Mennonite College of Nursing. The facility includes assessment and skill labs, a virtual hospital unit, and patient simulators. Milner Library is moving rapidly toward creating a collaborative, technology-rich environment that facilitates better outcomes for student learning and faculty research. Enhancements this year at Milner include new work, podcasts, and collaboration stations, the addition of iPads for circulation, and a new multimedia center, to name just a few Milner improvements. And of course, just last spring, we formally dedicated the new home of our School of Kinesiology and Recreation at the newly renovated McCormick Hall and named our College of Business building after State Farm Insurance, a corporate partner that has invested tens of millions of dollars into our academic enterprise. Facility enhancements for support services include the completion of Uptown Crossing and the continuing renovation of Hovey Hall, which will soon house both admissions and financial aid. For students, the progress has been simply tremendous. Under construction, just west of campus, is the new Cardinal Court apartment complex, our first and very successful public-private housing partnership. Of our six remaining student residence halls, five have been renovated, and the sixth, Watterson Towers, is more than halfway through its extensive rehabilitation process. Student Fitness Center, which opened last spring, continues to be a very popular destination for not only students, but faculty, staff members, local alumni, and retirees. Student Fitness Center draws more than 16,000 visits each week. These are just a few of the dozens of campus enhancements that have been completed over the past several years or are scheduled for completion during the coming year. We can be proud of these accomplishments and equally proud of the creative methods used to achieve our shared facilities goals. Still, much remains to be done. The badly needed rehabilitation of our fine arts complex awaits the breakup of a political and budgetary logjam in Springfield. I'm confident there will be some movement soon, and it's possible that before the end of this fiscal year, we will secure at least a small measure of capital funds to begin planning for a new fine arts complex. In addition, we must find ways to address a mounting backlog of unmet facility maintenance and enhancement needs in several of our academic colleges and, of course, our library. Another facility that needs to be addressed is Hancock Stadium. Hancock Stadium serves as the home field for Redbird football games, which in and of itself makes it an important venue for our campus and community. But as we all know, Hancock Stadium is much more. It is literally the most visible front door to our campus. It's the first structure most people see when arriving at Illinois State from Main Street. Hancock Stadium is where Illinois Special Olympics kicks off its summer games, drawing thousands of participants and their family and friends who gather each year to cheer them on. It's the statewide host for a variety of summer camps. Many young people and their families get their first impression of Illinois State when they visit Hancock Stadium. It's also used for a variety of community events, both athletic and recreational. Hancock Stadium is in an important location, and it serves many important roles. It's a quickly noticed landmark that should reflect the top quality and high standards of this institution. Unfortunately, it does the exact opposite. I'll be blunt. Hancock Stadium is an eyesore. It doesn't welcome guests, it turns them away. When it was built 50 years ago, Hancock Stadium was a fine, proud facility. But during these last 50 years, the infrastructure hasn't received a single significant upgrade, and it threatens to become an embarrassment. Hancock Stadium's functions are too important, its placement on campus too central to allow its deterioration to continue. Today, after consulting with student, faculty, staff, and governing board leadership, I'm announcing a project to significantly upgrade Hancock Stadium by the fall semester of 2013. The renovations I propose are many, including a new east side grandstand with brick columns and glass walls that offer an attractive and inviting presence on Main Street. We will also create an outdoor terrace space as well as suite and club seating to attract and steward donors and potential donors. Improvements will also be made to the stadium concession areas and restrooms. I estimate the investment for this project to be about $20 million. We will pay for this investment through a variety of funding mechanisms. 3 years ago, our Board of Trustees approved a $1.5 million expenditure to plan for the eventual upgrade of Hancock Stadium. After tearing down the south end zone stands this summer and installing a new west side bleacher complex, the remaining funds will be dedicated to this new project. Student fees will be a prime source of funding, but I want to stress that this project will not trigger a hike in student fees, nor will we ask students to pay any new fees. The fees students already pay to support athletics and other campus facilities will be directed toward the Hancock Stadium project. Finally, we'll continue to seek funding from outside the university, mostly in the form of gifts. I can tell you today that we have several groups interested in joining Illinois State in this initiative. More details will follow as they become available. I'm fully aware that there are people who will disagree with the notion of investing large sums of money into Hancock Stadium, particularly during a difficult economic environment. To those people, I can only say, renovating this landmark has been a priority of mine since I became president 8 years ago, and quite simply, it needs to be done. One of the casualties of a weak economy is timing, and because of the needs of faculty, staff, and students, other priorities rose higher and faster than Hancock. But now we must act. Our student athletes, coaches, athletic staff, and all of our Redbird fans deserve this. The entire university community will benefit from the project, as will our community partners in Normal and Bloomington. We all need Hancock Stadium to reflect the excellence and growing reputation of Illinois State. In February of 2012, I'll ask the Board of Trustees to formally approve the Hancock Stadium renovation, and I believe they'll support this most important initiative. I also want to congratulate our athletics department for being one of 27 programs nationwide to meet the certification requirements recently by the NCAA. A certified designation denotes that an institution operates its athletics program in compliance with operating principles adopted by the Division I membership. There are 45 NCAA Division I institutions in this certification class. Particularly want to thank Certification Chair Dr. Jan Murphy for her outstanding leadership and the trustees, faculty, staff, and alumni who served on the committees during the entire process. This was a great team effort, and as the team members know, it was a lot of work. The final topics I want to address are initiatives which will also require a team approach. The revision of our single most important university document, our strategic plan, Educating Illinois, and a new information technology strategic plan. Since its implementation more than a decade ago, Educating Illinois has helped transform Illinois State into what it is today, a top choice public institution, and a destination for quality faculty, staff members, and motivated students. It has helped us lift graduation and retention rates to historic highs. It has helped move faculty salaries closer to peer group averages and has pushed support staff salaries to, and in some cases, beyond peer levels. It has also helped increase diversity and earn us the designation as a military-friendly campus. Educating Illinois has helped Illinois State become a Kiplinger Top 100 University institution for 7 straight years. It has helped make fundraising a priority, leading to our first ever comprehensive fundraising campaign, Redefining Normal. Educating Illinois served as the guide for our campus master plan. It boosted our rankings in U.S. News and World Report. Educating Illinois also helped us double our commitment to providing student scholarships for both need and merit. Educating Illinois has been revised twice since 2001, and today I'm announcing a third revision. If you notice the vice presidents shuffling their feet, they have more work coming their way. I've charged the vice presidents, Lazelle, Everts, Monet, and Dietz, with beginning the pre-planning process yet this fall. I envision the campus phase of the revision to begin in the spring of 2012, with a goal of bringing a draft for Academic Senate review during the fall 12 semester. Hope to achieve Board of Trustees' endorsement of the revision by February of 2013. Although the update will be led by a team with cross-campus representation, all of you are the true authors of Educating Illinois. I urge you once again to participate in creating our newest path to success. In addition, over the next 3 to 5 years, we will also need to focus attention on closing the gap between IT services demand and what we are able to provide. The new IT Strategic Plan 2011 to 2013 outlines a comprehensive list of action items that are needed over this time period. Preliminary estimates of the cost for the more urgent of these action items show that we need to undertake a cost-benefit analysis of the IT services currently provided. A first step in this direction is to look at our current investment of resources to ensure that all IT activities across campus are still needed, complementary of one another, and being offered without waste or duplication of efforts. In an effort to mobilize the entire ISU IT community to help find a solution to this problem, I have charged the vice presidents with creating a comprehensive 3 to 5 year IT plan. That plan will identify the current IT services and captures the total IT cost to the institution, analyze and measure these services based on a common framework, provide an analysis of the gap between the current state of IT services and those recommended in the IT Strategic Plan action items, and of course provide a set of recommendations for how current IT resources can be reallocated to more effectively close this gap. Finally, I'm personally looking forward to another successful and fulfilling year at Illinois State. We've scheduled an outstanding series of speakers for the fall and early spring semesters, and I hope you'll take advantage of these important lectures. Fine Arts will offer a variety of art exhibits, musical productions, and theatrical performances. Homecoming Week invites us to get in the game, October 10th through the 16th, and I invite you to attend the dozens of homecoming activities and to support our Redbird athletes all year long. Our student leaders have also provided us with a great way to embrace our Redbird traditions by passing an SGA resolution encouraging everyone to wear red to campus each Friday. I'm glad to tell our student leadership that I've been collecting red ties since 1978. I haven't thrown any away. Some of them are still in style. So you'll see me wearing red each Friday, and I trust all of you will help spread the red too. And I know Dan Holland will wear his red sport coat from time to time. Also want to say thank you. Some institutions use the word engaged as a catchphrase for a brochure, a website, or a soundbite. But the people who are Illinois State University walk the talk. You are fully engaged in the classroom, research laboratory, and throughout the campus community. Just as important, you engage the greater community, and I know the people of Normal, Bloomington, and McLean County also know and appreciate your involvement. You build homes for people who might otherwise not have a home. You help people with vision, speech, and hearing disorders. You run errands, mow lawns, and shovel snow for those who have trouble leaving their homes. You make our environment more attractive and more sustainable through projects such as the Community Food Waste Compost Project. You read to children and help them run and throw and catch better. You teach people how to grow things, how to appreciate nature. You sing, play music, and act for appreciative local audiences. Everything you do as an extension of your service to Illinois State brings the university and community closer together. You have built a cohesive university community, and you have created strong and lasting bonds with the greater community. Thank you also for supporting me during my 8 years of president. You have embraced me and my family. You have treated me with kindness and respect. Your criticisms have been constructive. When you have been skeptical, you have never been cynical. You have provided me with excellent leadership and lasting relationships. Illinois State is not a perfect university, but because of you, I will always feel that it is the perfect place for me. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, President Bowman. Dr. Bowman will be glad to answer a few questions in our remaining time. For those of you who have questions, there are microphones in the aisles, and if you have questions, please use one of those so everyone can hear. And in addition, our faculty and staff newsletter solicited emailed questions, and I'll start things off by reading a couple of those. So, number one, President Bowman, could you please respond to the removal of thousands of items from Milner Library's third floor and placed into storage? Many faculty members were upset over that decision.
I heard from all those faculty members, or at least the provost or I. I understand the concerns. I guess there are two responses. One, major changes need to be made at the library. It originally was built to house 800,000 volumes. Today it has over 1.6 million. The number of seats has been in free fall. We've simply run out of space, and we need to put more of our holdings into storage, make them easily accessible, but also embrace, the library needs to embrace technology as the world moves forward. Most of the concerns, I think, related to the communication within the library and between the library and academic units. And the communication should be better, and the provost and I have addressed those issues. But we are unfortunately in a holding pattern. The library is in many ways the victim of its own success. As state appropriations have declined, we have not stopped investing in library materials, and so our holdings have continued to increase, but the building has simply run out of room. The long-term solution, obviously, is to build an addition, renovate the current library, and that will certainly be done in due time. Okay. Not as quickly as we want, though.
Okay. All right. Related to that, then, we have a second email question. Is, given that concrete funding for our new library is probably at least 10 years away, what is your vision for the future of our current library as we strive to accommodate competing needs and desires? Would you support a campus-wide planning process so that faculty, students, staff, subject librarians, alumni, and friends of the library could participate directly in live, face-to-face, open forums to determine the best use of space within the current library and start planning towards space needs and space allocations in a new facility once we do receive funding?
Only a faculty member would ask a question like that. And, you know, questions shouldn't have 200 words in them. It's hard to remember what the question was when you get to the end. I'm one of those people. that planning effort is being contemplated and will begin soon. We need to look toward a library for the future that both embraces sort of traditional features associated with libraries, the heritage of a library, as well as technology that's available today and that will be available in the future. Not an easy task, but as I see Dan Brady and Senator Bill Brady sitting in front of me, I don't think they think it'll take 10 years to get that building done. And I know they're thinking, that's way too long for Illinois State University to wait. Not to put words in their mouths.
I've got a couple more. Still would like to invite people in the audience to come to the microphones if they have their own questions. And this one is, Dr. Bowman, do you feel that the use of new security employees on campus has increased safety both on and around campus?
The security force, it was not a cheap investment. The Board of Trustees swallowed long and hard. It was a very expensive contract. But I think it has made a major difference. If you look at the level of crime on campus, it has never been high, but compared this fall to last fall, it is much better. And I think having a presence, having more people on the ground has made a huge difference. Plus, it has helped free up our sworn officers to do more traditional kind of police work. Keeping a secure campus is an absolute high priority for my office and obviously for the Board of Trustees. And I think the investment is worth it. It's something that's probably going to be part of our campus expenses for the foreseeable future.
All right. I'm beginning to run out of questions. Yes.
Good afternoon, President Bowman. My name is Lindsay Vaugh. I work in the Office of Admissions. First, I want to say thank you for hosting the underrepresented faculty staff engagement at the beginning of the semester. It was really nice to see people that you never even knew existed on this campus, even though we're a part of overlapping cultures. My question is, what are the additional diversity efforts that are going to be going on in this next academic year?
I'll say a couple of things before I get to your question. I'm very happy with a number of things that have happened on this campus. First of all, the climate, I think, has improved greatly since the 1970s. And that has created a more welcoming environment and is probably partially responsible for the increase in diversity in the student body. The diversity task force that worked in 2008 in assessing some of our current practices and gave some recommendations for going forward convened again this past spring and has additional recommendations that are available on the president's website, and I encourage you to look at that and respond and give us your feedback. There are a lot of diversity efforts underway on campus that aren't visible unless you really look for them. And this summer, the media relations unit put together a very nice publication that we distributed widely that collected a lot of that information and I think in a very very attractive way
demonstrated the institution's commitment to diversity and all of the activity that that's underway. The country, the state, is becoming more and more diverse, and the institution, I think, is moving in the right direction, but we're always looking for ways to improve. I will say one other thing, not related to diversity, but today is the first day that WZND has an on-air broadcast signal, and we're pretty excited. I know they're happy to be on the FM airwaves, and so that that's a great effort. Excellent work is being done in school of communications, and congratulations to that group for all the hard work it took to get there. Now yes. I'm in trouble.
Justin.
You know, I was on a roll till
no,
now.
No, President Bowman, I usually ask the question, do you want fries with that? But I won't ask that today. So.
I love French fries, Bob. Okay. If I didn't love French fries, I'd tell you I love French fries.
But I just wanted to congratulate you on your very recent award of the Regional Leadership Award that you were just given in the paper in that.
Thank you very much.
But I think it really reflects the that this community is recognized beyond the boundaries of Bloomington Normal of the leadership and the changes that have gone on with Illinois State University. And we're very proud to have you as our president and many more years to come. Thank you.
Absolutely. When I ended the speech, I thought, it sort of sounds like a farewell address, and I'm only 58 years, I'm going to be here a long time, so that was not a farewell address, and glad to hear my boss say that he expects me to be around, so that's good. Awards like that don't happen unless the campus is doing well, and the three things that I'm most proud of relative to this campus are the improvements in student quality, the improvements in our facilities. We've made a lot of progress the last 15 years. And thirdly, the improvements in our academic programs and our national reputation. That transformation is like nothing that I've seen anywhere else across the country. And it's something we all should be proud of. Job security, too.
I have one more email question for you, which is, after Southside is eventually torn down, what are some of the plans that are being considered to replace it?
Yeah, we're still giving some thought to exactly what should happen. Those buildings, because they don't have sprinkler systems, we can't use them as residence halls anymore without a very large investment. I've heard rumors that we're going to build more residence halls, and we are certainly not in the business of building residence halls. We are thinking about units that could be located in that location. It's a prime location. College of Nursing obviously has been mentioned in our master plan. Temporarily, the buildings could be used as surge space as we work on other campus buildings. We've got a lot of renovation projects plan for the future. We could use part of those buildings for storage. So it's still a work in progress, but unfortunately their days as residence halls are over. You know you're aging when the buildings that were here when you started working here are being torn down. But these are good changes for our campus. Walker Hall, I heard from an awful lot of alumni who said, how can you tear down Walker Hall? And, very well-built building, and it took a lot of work to tear it down. It was so well-built. But it had outlived its usefulness. It was very difficult to renovate, big, thick concrete walls, and no air conditioning. It was very difficult to retrofit technology in the building, and it was simply time to move on. And same thing is true for those four towers.
Okay. If there's no further questions, I'd like to thank you all for coming one more time. I'd also like to thank President Bowman again, and I invite you all to join us for a reception in the lobby.